Okay. Hello everybody. I'm very grateful to be here. Thanks for the kind introductory words. Thanks for the kind invitation to this excellent conference. So my topic is the political economy of populism. What I want to present in the next half hour is a condensed version of a book which only has appeared in German so far with exactly the identical title, The Political Economy of Populism. Whether there will be an English translation soon, I don't know. Okay, when writing that, or when I started to write that book, one of the starting observations was this. So this is the 2014 European election, and it's a very simple do-it-yourself kind of graph. It takes some of the parties which usually are claimed to be populist, measures the vote share of these parties, and then simply multiplies it with their position on a left-right scale, from 0 extreme left to 10 extreme right. And whenever we have more than one populist party, or one party usually characterized as populist in a political system, I just consolidated the measures. So, for instance, Rassemblement National and La Front de Gauche in the French European elections, or Cinque Stelle and Lega. And why did I take the European elections? Well, they are, you know, they take place roughly under the same identical electoral rules, which is of course very helpful if you compare countries with majoritarian rules like France and UK to countries with PR. They all take place at the same, more or less at the same day. So that was one of the starting observations. And the starting observation is this: if we differentiate between left-wing populism and right-wing populism, the South is left, the North is right. So this is already 6 years ago now. We had European elections last year. And the picture changed a little bit, but not fundamentally. As you all know, Lega and Cinque Stelle changed places, whereas Cinque Stelle still had, even in the national elections in 2019, was much larger than Lega, 31% to something like 17%. They changed places, as you all know, and that was one of the reasons why Matteo Salvini thought it's a smart move to leave the coalition, and it turned out it was not such a smart move. But that's, then the other thing which really changed from 2014 to 2019 was we saw for the first time a right-wing populist party in Spain emerging, Vox. But by and large, with these kind of exceptions, the picture generally still held in 2019. So still we have the dominance of right-wing populism in Europe's north, and a much stronger left-wing populist movement in Europe's south. And I thought a comparative theory of populism should be able to say something about this very strong and stable and striking variation. Some of the other observations also concern geographical patterns, so to speak. Of course, being a German, one is very much interested in the German story. As you all know, AfD failed to enter German parliament in 2013. It then succeeded in entering the European Parliament in 2014, and then, and finally, after entering all state parliaments in the meantime, it also entered the German Bundestag in 2017. So again, here is a kind of geographical pattern of the success of these new right-wing populist party, which I think needs explanation. So the general story also in Germany is very much an East-West story. So of course, yes, the AfD is much more successful in the East than in the West. So this is the left-hand panel. These are the vote shares in the 2017 election in September. But there's also hidden and not often discussed a south-north story, because the AfD is both successfully in the south of the East, Saxony, but also relatively successful in the south of the West, Bavaria, Baden-Württemberg. In the Baden-Württemberg election, the AfD surpassed the Social Democrats with 14% to 12%. And this is also not a very easily explained pattern, since we know that both the south of the East and the south of the West, these are the economically thriving, the successful, the good performing, highly globalized parts of Germany, where the German industrial model is still intact, and where you have a lot of world champions, all the automobile industry in Bavaria and Baden-Württemberg, all the new industry in Saxony. So if you have any measure of deprivation, no matter what, long-term unemployed, people on dependent on social assistance, share of young mothers, distance to the next hospital, whatever deprivation index you use, the South and the East and the South and the West are not the deprived regions. So any explanation saying, okay, populism is the outlet of those who have been forgotten, those, you know, modernization losers, globalization losers, marginalized, precarious, that's not really, at least from simple eyeballing, this is not the story the German pattern gives you. And the same would be true for Italy. It is not so surprising if the Lega, which for most of its time was a regional party, ethno-regionalist party, is not very successful in the south, even if it has turned into a right-wing populist party, dropped the north in its the Northern League in its name, and tried to mobilize in the south. But still, I think it's a pattern in need of explanation that Movimento has this very southern stronghold, whereas the rich regions, Emilia-Romagna, the globalized regions, the highly internationalized connected regions of Italy, vote Liga with a much higher tendency than any other place in Italy. So these were the kind of starting observations, and I thought, a comparative explanation, maybe even a comparative political economy explanation of populism, needs to address these issues. So there are mainly two questions, and it's a kind of why now and why there question, as Giso et Alita posted in a recent paper. So we need some kind of explanation for why is it now, and I don't address that topic so much. Yves Meny said, I think, many important things on that. I will rather address the why here and the kind of geographical pattern question. So the argument in a nutshell is really saying, okay, this has something to do with different European political economies. I will mainly concentrate on Europe. We might have the chance afterwards to say something concerning other regions of the world. So I will concentrate mainly on Europe. And I would say that populism, at least as a kind of, with respect to triggering events, is very much a response to globalization shocks. But then this can be made more concrete in saying, okay, We had various globalization shocks in the recent past, the financial crisis 2008, which then transformed into the euro crisis in 2010. Following would be one manifestation of a globalization shock. The refugee crisis after 2015 would be another, and with respect to central middle European, Eastern European countries, I would say the long effects of the transformation shock 1990 following should also be part of the picture. So my talk is wants to pursue the following steps. I will give a brutally short, very very unfair characterization of my take of the populism debate, combined with a very short critique. I will then try to briefly sketch an own argument, which is a political economy argument that has been much inspired by a very short paper by Daniel Roderick in 2018 about the political economy of globalization and populism. And then I will provide a very rough explanation for this peculiar pattern we see between North and South, East and West. I will present some empirics, and then my time will definitely be over. So, with some tendency of simplification, I think we can divide the literature into broadly three approaches. The one has been mentioned already, connected to names like Klaus Mürde, Cristobal Kaltwasser, Jan Werner Müller, and really looking at rhetoric, at style, and as populism, as we already heard, as a very thin ideology, anti-pluralist, and juxtaposing the pure people against the corrupt elite. So my problem with this kind of literature is that it really abstracts away from any substantial dimension. And then quite explicitly, this kind of thin ideology, and that it can be connected to the left and to the right, and that it is unrelated to the left-right distinction, or in the words of Jan Werner Müller, populism isn't about policy content. As a political scientist, or also as a comparativist, I think, well, we see this variation, and I have to say that I'm concerned whether I'm ruled by a left-wing populist or by a right-wing populist. So I found this not very satisfactory, saying, okay, this has nothing to do with substantial politics. And so I thought, well, one of the important questions, why do we see this kind of populism here and why do we that kind of populism there, is not really addressed in that literature. It's rather about the consequences, not about the causes. And I, granted that this is a very relevant question, I would still say, okay, but there is an irrelevant question out there which is not addressed really in that literature, and saying, okay, why, if it's a thin ideology which can be linked to notions of the nation or notions of class, why is it that it is connected in some circumstances to the one, and why is it that in other circumstances is connected to the other? In older literature, already reacting to that phenomenon in the late 80s, 90s, because populist parties are not with us since yesterday, we have seen the SVP in Switzerland, the PVV earlier, the Danish Folkepartiet also earlier, already starting sometimes in the 70s. So in earlier literature, connected to names like Duan Zwang or Betz, and then also to more recent authors, makes this art of argument, saying, okay, these are losers of deindustrialization, these are losers of technological change, of increased international competition, and so on and so on. So these are really, outside labor market outsiders, marginalized, those in precarious jobs, and so on and so on. So my problem with that literature and the kind of German map I showed you, and also the Italian map with Lega, its strongholds in the thriving, very, very much competitive regions of Emilia-Romagna and so on. My problem is that this might be a story that is sometimes true, but it's clearly not. Clearly not a universal explanation for what we see. There can be many reasons why it is often falsified empirically, as for instance in the German case, whatever measure of deprivation you put in any regression, it will not give you a good model for what is happening in the German case. So there are many reasons why this can be, but I think it's clear that it's empirically maybe sometimes true, but clearly and somewhere true. So the Brexit story, maybe also the deindustrialized regions of the American Rust Belt, who then turned not voting Democratic anymore, but voting Republican. So there is evidence that something of that happens from time to time in some places, but it's clearly not an explanation which gives us the whole picture. The third explanation is quite complicated because it says, in different variants, of course you have a purely culturalist argument provided by Pippa Norris and Engelhardt, and saying, okay, it's simply a cultural backlash. Simply, I don't know, angry white man, you know, unsatisfied what happened since the late 1960s, early 1970s. Again, I would say, okay, this cannot really explain us any variation. It also cannot tell us about the temporal, why now, you know, why the resistance now and not 10 years ago or 15 years ago or 20. So, but I think in a more sophisticated way, we have an argument put forward by people like Hans-Peter Krisi and others, also by Hugo Marx, and saying, okay, it's a kind of combination of cultural and economic features which play a role here. So there's a new cleavage line, whatever you call it, integration versus demarcation, Gall versus Tang, green alternative libertarian versus traditional authoritarian nationalist. However, so everybody comes with an own name, but they all mean the same. It's new cleavage line, has to do something with economic globalization, has to do something with political globalization. So the loss of national sovereignty over policies, we heard about that already from Yves Meny, but also cultural globalization, migration mainly. So and on this cleavage line, we see the sorting of voters, of citizens, according to economic groups. So these are non-economic conflicts, but the response to these conflicts, whether you are a cosmopolitan or whether you are a communitarian, is very much driven by work logics. So this is a very complicated argument saying, okay, although we have we are confronted with a new type of conflict, the response pattern we see very much falls into the pattern of working logics. So, and that in a way is a response to the empirical problems which the modernization loser explanation has, because we see workers overrepresented in the electorate of the new populist parties, but we don't see measures of deprivation, at least not everywhere, really triggering this response. So my problem with that literature is it says it's almost exclusively directed to the right-wing populism problem. So it has also a selection bias. It looks, you know, it looks only at those countries where you see right-wing populists. So Southern Europe is often out of the picture. So you see the kind of sampling on the dependent variable, every student learns this in the first and second semester, you shouldn't do this. But then also as soon as we look into the whole variation, this work logic argument really gets into trouble, because then you would have to ask why is a Swedish worker more xenophobic than a Spanish worker, although they all belong to the same work logic. So what I try to put forward is an argument, as I said, very much inspired by a very short piece by Danny Roderick, but which also comes out of a longer, bigger literature, and that's, of course, a comparative political economy literature, and that's, of course, also a varieties of capitalism literature, so also very much, you know, more fundamentally inspired by people like David Soskis and Iversen and so on. So the Roderick argument is very, very simple in saying, okay, we should understand populism as a response to globalization, to globalization shocks. And he differentiates two kinds of globalization shocks. The one is the traditional, what we usually understand when we say globalization, so it's simply the movement of goods and capital across borders. And then he says, okay, whenever the globalization shock manifests itself in this form, you will get a left-wing populist response, because that's the genuine, also the kind of ideological field for the left. But then there is a second dimension, and that's the movement of people across borders, aka migration. And whenever the globalization shock comes as that, you will see a right-wing populist response, because this is clearly not the field of the left, but rather the field of the right. So how can this help us to explain the variance? Well, as we already learned in the financial and then in the euro crisis, we know that at least if you look at Western Europe, we have at least three different political economies. I will concentrate first on the North-South divide, and although usually in that comparative political economy literature we differentiate between a Scandinavian model and a continental one, at least to globalization they are very similar. They have absolutely no problem with the movement of goods and capital across borders. Quite to the contrary, that's their very essence, that's their working logic, that's their growth logic. So, coming from Germany as a export champion, as you know. So all these countries, Scandinavia, Netherlands, Belgium, Austria, Swiss, Germany, they are all export-led growth models. So it's not only so that they don't have problems with the kind of economic globalization. That's their quintessential logic. That's how they function. That's how they generate growth and wealth. To do this, we know from a literature starting from Katzenstein, but including Roderick himself, we know that these export-oriented growth models go together with a very generous welfare state. I could go into much more detail, I don't have the time to do this, but all these countries host very generous, quite accessible welfare states. And that's, I think, one of the reasons why they are not vulnerable. That's one of the reasons why they are not vulnerable vis-a-vis economic globalization, because they compensate losers. But because the compensation is quite generous, they have a problem with migration. In the South, as we also learned from the euro crisis, it's not an export-led growth model, it's rather a domestic demand growth model. And that always has been very much dependent on the state of generating both public and private debt, and of having this kind of domestic demand stimulus through both kinds of debts. And we know since the euro that these countries cannot deliver anymore on that growth model, because they don't have the sovereignty anymore to run into either private or public debt. That's what they learned in the harshest possible way after 2010. So they have a problem with the free movement of goods and capital, because the welfare state is not really a compensating element in this whole arrangement. It's still very generous if you look at if you look simply at share of GDP. Of social expenditures, but it's not accessible, it's not universal, it's very much particularistic, and it very much works in a, it's very much an old age pensioner state, and that's one of the reasons why it's not really vulnerable vis-a-vis migration. And I think that's at the core of the strong South-North divide that we see. So the I have to be a little bit more brief. As I see in the East-West dimension, we see both of these kind of countries, if you take the Anglo-Saxon liberal countries as well as the Eastern Middle European countries, they either have no generous welfare state because they don't want to, Anglo-Saxon countries, or they still cannot afford it to do this. So they don't have a real problem with migration into the welfare state. At least the Anglo-Saxon model have a problem with migration into the labor market. And that would say that we would see, so in a very much liberalized, deregulated, hire and fire labor market, labor migration gets problematic. But so all of these countries, usually Canada, the US itself, Australia, New Zealand, but also the UK, they depend on a strict migration regime. So this kind of political economy depends on that. The political support for the whole political economy, and that's, in a very essence, the story of the Brexit. I will come to the Eastern European countries in a minute, because here I would really say, okay, these are the transformation losers after 1999, so it's rather the segments in the agriculture sector or in the old heavy industry sector which lost by the transformation. But then, because we know these countries, they don't have any migration, not substantially at least. But they have a lot of immigration, so they benefit from the European free movement regime. And so my prediction for the Eastern European countries would be, okay, if the new populist parties really mobilize those transformation losers, we should see a left-wing response in Europe, in Central Eastern Europe, and you will be surprised. Yes, we do. So that would be the kind of general analytical framework. Either is, you know, is the cross-border movement of persons problematic for the political economy, yes or no? Is the free movement of capital and goods problematic for the political economy, yes or no? And then the only differentiation between, for instance, the Anglo-Saxon liberal world and the continental plus Scandinavian world is who is vulnerable? Are these labor market insiders, as in the continental Scandinavian model, or are these the labor market outsiders, as in the Anglo-Saxon model? So, roughly 3 minutes left for empirics, as I said. Okay, very, very roughly. So I think the first pieces of evidence is to show, yes, if we look at migration itself, it's already interesting, I think, to observe that that these political economies are differently affected. On the left-hand side, you see a positive relation between whatever measurement of welfare state generosity you take and so-called forced migration, and you see the expected clustering, so the Scandinavians, then the continental country ones, then the either the Anglo-Saxon liberal or the Southern European ones, and the picture is reversed as soon as you look at, you know, on the x-axis, how strictly regulated or not regulated is the labor market, and what's the share of labor migration into these countries. So, I skipped the data description. So, and I think the second piece of evidence, also already at a descriptive level, is also, I think, interesting, saying, okay, the problem perception is very different. So I simply took the Eurobarometer waves from 2015 to including the latest in 2017, and there was simply the question, and that's all on the descriptive level, what's the biggest the two biggest problems your country is confronted with? And you see there is a clear south-north divide, so migration is not perceived either in the east or the south as any problems. But it's very much perceived as a problem in the north by the respondents. So, and already if you have this very strong difference in problem perception I think it's no surprise that you also see very different political responses. And the picture is more or less flipped if you ask, either is the economy not doing well or is unemployment a problem? You see that you simply see the consequences of the big crisis. So if you look already at this kind of still rather descriptive evidence, it's not really surprising that you would see different forms of protest articulating themselves. Well, if you go into the more inferential statistical analysis, we could try to measure insiders, outsiders. Here in this graph, I would only like to highlight one simple message. Insider measured as those working on a regular contract over 30 hours a week. So they are completely identically defined in the North and in the South, and they just flip electoral choice from right to left completely, so not entirely significantly. This also comes out if you do a more, how do you say, sophisticated statistical analysis. I don't have too much time to go into this, but what we did here was taking the European Social Survey, 8 waves. I think we have, these are more than 250,000 observations. Depending on the observations you have on populist vote, this boils down to something like 15,500, still something with which you can work. But if you look at, for instance, the one determinant of the right-wing populist vote and a quite stable, very robust determinant predictor is the level of social security in a country. So this is what here, the minimum income protection yearly average. So there's a very strong connection between how generous and accessible universal is the welfare state. And interestingly, if you interact this with, for instance, asylum seekers per year, asylum seekers as such has a negative sign, so that there is not even, it's not even positively related, it's significantly negatively related, but an interaction term with the generosity of the welfare state is strongly stable, positively related to a right-wing populist vote. So, well, I spent my last 2-3 minutes by trying to solve the kind of Eastern puzzle. Because, as you might remember, my kind of prediction would be, say, okay, if populism here is really mobilizing those who felt left behind after the, you know, after the great transformation these countries underwent, then the prediction of my theory would say, okay, we should see a left-brain populist response in Central Eastern Europe. And now you would say, okay, now in that point he's definitely wrong. Look at PiS, look at Fidesz. So what is going to do with that? So my response would be to say, yes, of course we would perceive. Although we also have Smer in Slovakia and the Romanian Social Democrats, where one could talk about saying, okay, they are not so different from Fidesz and PiS in their programmatic stance, in their Euroscepticism, and so on, in their cultural conservatism. What I wanted to point out is that in many, many Eastern, Central Eastern European countries, the dimensional space of politics is inverted. So if we, from a Western perspective, look at that, we, of course, identify Fidesz or PiS as, of course, right-wing populist parties. But if we differentiate the political space into a socio-economic left-right dimension here on the x-axis and a socio-cultural left-right dimension here named Tan versus Skull, tradition authoritarian nationalist versus green alternative libertarian, then the dimensionality of the political space is really different between West and East. And I think one has to take this into account. In other words, the combination which many of the new populist parties now also in the West imitate is a combination of being socioeconomically left, strong state, anti-globalization, anti-Europe, protectionism, and being social cultural right. And that's from the Western perspective, it's an unusual combination, because here we would say, okay, if you're social culturally left, you're also social economically left, and vice versa. But I would say a voter seeking protection, for instance, from a neoliberal European project, has very good reasons to vote for PiS or Fidesz, because on the socioeconomic, and not for the civic platform, for instance, in Poland, because on the socioeconomic dimension, these are the parties that are offering protection and shelter. I skipped the summary, because the summary simply summarizes, and thank you for your attention.